To say the Bay of Naples was astonishing was understatement. The great sweep, from the southern point of Sorrento all the way round to the promontory of Bacoli, was gifted with enough references all the way back to classical antiquity to mean its beauty should come as no surprise. Yet it did, for with the sun full up, and distance enough to hide any flaws, it provided a stunning panorama of the city, high buildings, church spires, and the two castles, one of which dominated the port itself, the other, St. Elmo, high above and menacing. To the south, towering above and beyond the entire panorama, lay the twin peaks of Vesuvius, seemingly so gentle, one top smoking, as if it were in possession of a good pipe of tobacco, the other dormant. Yet it was still an object of some terror, for what it had done in the past was as much referred to as the city and the landscape over which it held fearful dominance. As they came closer in, the long frontage of the royal palace became the dominant feature in a bay now full of traffic. Emily, standing in the prow, with her long hair blowing in the wind, was too much of an attraction for the Neapolitan males who caught sight of her. With an amused smile, Pierce noticed how tillers were put down and courses altered to bring the local fishermen and small trading ships across their path, so that those steering and manning them could blow her kisses, and no doubt, for it was too much a dialect to comprehend, issue invitations to engage in any number of trysts. The smell was the first thing that dented the image of Naples and the bay, and this to folk who were no strangers to urban stink. The city was in serious need of a downpour to clear away the accumulated filth of its teeming population, though in fairness, that was a truth that could be applied to any busy port. Yet the climate here made the odour near to overpowering, and it seemed to Pierce that perhaps that was what altered his lover's happy mood.